Given the deaths of recent days, by all accounts, historically momentous, is good and get together and have a conversation. My name is Jonathan Tran. I serve as a faculty student at the Honors Residential College, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the 2016 Drumwright Gathering Lecture, a conversation with Professor Robert George of Princeton University and Professor John Haldane of Haldane University. The title of their extremely relevant conversation is Reasons for Our Hope, the Role of Faith in Politics, Culture, and Education. Moderating will be Baylor's Executive Vice President and Provost, Professor Greg Jones. It is wonderful to have with us, along with the Baylor community and the Waco community, members of the Drumwright family. To say a bit more about them, I want to welcome up Honors College Dean Tom Hibbs, Distinguished Professor of Ethics and Culture, and Director of Baylor in Washington, D.C.
Thank you, Jonathan, and thanks to everyone for being with us today. It's a real honor to hold, once again, the Drumwright Family Lecture, in this case, a conversation instead of a lecture, today here in the Honors Residential College. And we want today, in a special way, to honor and commemorate the Drumwright family. Many generations of Drumwrights have attended Baylor, graduating first in 1909 and stretching to the not too distant future. We have a great grandson of Manette and Huber, who was born in May of 2016 and is on track to graduate with the class of 2038. So this is one of these great family Baylor traditions. And we especially honor Manette Drumwright Pratt, who is with us today. Manette has been a friend of many of us in this room. She's been a friend of the Honors College, I think, from before it existed. She was a supporter of the idea, of the board. She has been on the advisory board of the Honors College for many years. She has promoted and supported our vision of undergraduate Christian liberal education. Passionately and enthusiastically. She's joined today by two of her daughters, Mimi and Debbie, who are delighted to have with us here. And I want to ask now to commemorate the permanent endowment of this lecture series at Baylor. I want to ask Daniel Notman and Hope Loomis. Daniel's a student here in the Honors Residential College, and Hope is our development director, to come and present a plaque to the family.
Madison Program, American Ideals and Institutions at Princeton University.
civil rights. He has served on the President's Council on High Ethics and UNESCO's World Commission on the Ethics of Science and Technology. He's published numerous books and scores of articles. He's also, as is Dr. Haldane, a noted public intellectual, and as I hope they will not take that as an insult, being called a public intellectual. These are people who bring their disciplines to bear on public questions. And Robbie has published in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Post, National Review, First Thing, City Journal, Times Literary Summit. We're delighted, Robbie, to have you with us again back here at Baylor. John Haldane. Now, John is a member of our faculty, and we're honored to have him here as the J. Newton Razor Senior Distinguished Professor of Philosophy. He also still holds a position as Professor of Philosophy at the University of St. Andrews, the Chair of the Royal Institute of Philosophy in London, and Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Holds degrees in Fine Arts and Philosophy and a PhD from London University. Haldane is a consultant to the Pontifical Council of Culture and is a member of the Pontifical Academies of St. Thomas Aquinas and of Life and Vatican. He also has published many books and scores of articles and has articles and appearing in numerous public fora and has had a series even on the BBC that he led public radio. We're delighted to have the two of them here. John is one of those people who's with us, but unless you're in one of his classes, you might not be have a chance to hear from him. He and Robbie have been interlocutors and friends for many years, and we're delighted that John agreed to join us. Greg Jones, Vice President and Provost at Baylor University, was formerly Senior Strategist for Leadership Education at Duke Divinity School and Professor of Theology and Christian Ministry. He was for 14 years the Dean of Duke Divinity School. He served as a Senior Strategist for the Pupil Coach K Center on Leadership and Ethics at Duke School of Business. The author, as well, the editor of 16 books, the two most important books, a recent book in Christian Social Innovation, and a book that has been widely influential called Embodying Forgiveness. Greg, thanks for taking time out of your very busy schedule to be with us today, and I hand it over to our provost.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you all for coming. When Tom asked if I'd be willing to moderate this conversation, it was easy to say yes. It wasn't taking time out of a busy schedule. This is actually fun, and really, I'm just inviting you all to overhear a conversation I'd like to have with two people whose writings I've admired for a long time on really important topics. The topic that the heading for this afternoon is sufficiently narrow that we may run out of things to talk about. Reasons for our hope, the role of faith in politics, culture, and education. But we'll try to see if we can stretch it to make it at least for 45 minutes. I want to begin, John and Robbie, with a kind of a broad question. You know, we're 2 days on the heels of an election in the U.S. There was a rather eventful thing that happened in the U.K. this summer called Brexit. As you think about not so much the role of faith in politics and culture, but I'd just be interested in kind of your assessments of the landscape in the Anglo-American culture and what's going on more broadly, not about the specific events in either case, but what you would diagnose as what has been going on that has brought us to this place in the landscape of Anglo-American cultures.
Okay, you'd like me to start?
Yeah.
Yeah. I have to say, sort of seated in this position, we were just discussing a moment ago what song we should begin with.
But, there's something happening here where it is exactly clear. Yeah.
So maybe I could begin. I mean, I agree we should try. There's nothing much to begin by getting into the details of this kind of thing, but trying to get a picture of what might be happening more generally. But having said that, it probably is worth just me offering a remark or two by way of both, on one hand, contrast, but on the other hand, resemblance between Brexit, the situation, and the situation that has prevailed leading up to and then with the presidential election. I think that both the United Kingdom and the United States, in somewhat different ways and for different reasons, do think of themselves as exceptional in some way. I don't mean exceptionally fine or exceptionally good, but as it were set apart. Of course, it may go with that, one also thinks of oneself as rather special. But anyway, so far as exceptional is concerned, in the case of the United Kingdom, it sees itself as standing in a kind of unique relation to continental Europe, in virtue of its being an island, and also in virtue of the fact that it has not suffered invasion for 1,000 years. Whereas pretty much every country in Western Central Europe, and indeed in Eastern Europe, has within the lifetimes of people existing today, and then again of their parents, and then again of their grandparents, seen the troops of a foreign army march across their land. Now, or been subject to totalitarian regimes within their own country. So the history of warfare and defeat is a dark cloud settled over Europe, which remains in Europe. And I think to some extent Britain thinks that's more a European problem than it is its problem. And so it sees the European Union, which originally was an economic union, turning into a political project. A project driven by a kind of administrative bureaucracy that is unelected, whose purposes are addressed to the historic hostilities of Europe, particularly the hostility between France and Germany. And I think that people in the United Kingdom so in part they think, well, this isn't our issue, so why should we be subjected to a new style of global government, or certainly regional government, to solve what is a particular problem that isn't our problem? Now, I think that's part of the history of this. And again, I think in the United States, there's a historic sense of exceptionalism and a resistance to being drawn into foreign conflicts, partly because of the memory of the two world wars, but then especially Vietnam and so on. And I think that creates in each of these countries a particular consciousness about their own interest and their position in the world. And of course, they both had sort of quasi, in one case literally in the United States, sort of metaphorically imperial roles. This is one aspect of it, and I think a lot of people are just pushing back against this. So there is a kind of tendency, you might call it isolationism if you're critical of it, you might kind of call it sort of home first, if whether it's a critical term or not, or you may just say that, look, you know, the business of these national governments is with their own nations, not trying to, as it were, be caught up in globalizing tendencies. And I think that many people in these countries feel that, and particularly people who are not part of the sort of metropolitan social elites. Globalization has served the elites very well, and they think of themselves, as it were, as world travelers. And they like to sort of set themselves apart from national identities. They think of that as crude and vulgar and antagonistic and so on. So what has happened in these two countries is there's been a growing groundswell. And interestingly, again in both countries, the sort of industrial and post-industrial working classes that would have provided votes for the parties that were then the parties of the elites, basically the left-wing parties, have sort of deserted those parties and have been in search of other support and other expressions. And as it's happened in both cases, it's been sort of non-establishment figures who have done that. In the United Kingdom, Nigel Farage through the United Kingdom Independence Party, here Donald Trump was a kind of independent, I mean, formally speaking, Republican nominee, but a kind of independent. So I think that sort of sets, you know, some parallels and so on. Now, what's going on? Well, who knows, but the danger, I think it's an anti-globalizing movement. It's a movement for people who want to try to, you know, hold on to the kind of world that they understood and were raised within and so on. I think, however, there's one thing, and we may come to this, that is not happily yoked together, which is that I think that a lot of the people who are voting for UKIP or are voting for Trump are not actually social conservatives. They're not interested in the conservative agenda. They're interested in an economic agenda. They're interested in having jobs and getting their jobs back and so on. I think that some social conservatives have seen both UKIP on the one hand and Trump on the other as an opportunity. You know, they may feel some distaste about the characters, and may feel some distaste about the populism, but they think that it's an opportunity to sort of halt the progressive onslaught, as they say, the progressive movement. I actually think that's a mistake. I think that will turn out not to be the case, partly because I think these figures themselves are not social conservatives, so they've got no particular interest. Trump is not a social conservative, he's got no particular interest in advancing the causes, the traditional causes of social conservatism, I would say. So I think there are tears ahead. And the other thing, when social conservatives see that this is not a vehicle of restoration, I think the other thing where there are tears ahead is the question of governability. And the thing that I do worry about, less in Great Britain, which is a kind of meta-stable political order, I mean, it just hasn't seen a revolution since the 17th century, but I do think there are serious threats to the business of government now, and the ongoing of government, and the notions of civil friendship and civil association, and shared identities and so on. And that is a serious problem. And I think we're beginning to see, you know, ways in which that could go. I'm not sure how it will go. But I think it's more of a problem here. But in part, of course, because the elites and the established political parties rather despise this kind of underswell. They regard it as vulgar. They condescend to it. They're not interested in engaging with it. So that is hardly likely to secure the loyalty of people who are then voting for some of these radical alternative revolutionary figures. Anyway, that's an opening view.
And a very illuminating one. Before tossing my two cents in to the substantive discussion of the question that the provost has put to us, let me thank you, Greg, and Tom Hibbs, and the whole Baylor community for having me back. It's a joy to be back in this company. I want to say a special word of thanks to the Drumwright family for supporting this lecture and for supporting Baylor University, which is so much good, not just here in Texas, really, but around the country. So thank you very much, and I'm honored that you're here for it. And it's also great to be back with so many old friends. My friend Frankie Beckwith is here. My dear old friend Judge Starr is here somewhere. And to have an opportunity to meet new friends. Matt Anderson, I see back there, lots of friends, and an opportunity to meet new ones. So thank you very much. This is a kind of second home to me, if you don't mind my saying it. I'm a little more comfortable here, really, than I am at. I don't quite know why. It might have something to do with those things you were just talking about, John. But
this isn't a pitch for a job offer.
Well, how did you get?
Nicely done.
I think I hear that offer has just come through.
John,
if we could take a recess for a few minutes.
I think he has the contract.
John's comments were very illuminating, and let me just add really some reflections to that. If you go back to the late 1980s, early 1990s, I think you see the roots of what is now happening, at least in the United States. I obviously don't know the UK situation nearly as well. And I point to two things. One is Pat Buchanan's promise or threat. The youngsters probably don't know who Pat Buchanan is. But who, a mainstream conservative figure, had worked in the Nixon administration, had worked in the Reagan administration, and a kind of public intellectual in his own way as well, who promised or threatened when he was challenging George H.W. Bush for re-election in the Republican primaries. He promised or threatened that he would lead a revolution of peasants with pitchforks. I didn't take him seriously, although he got something of a following, enough to actually derail the Bush campaign and give us Clinton. It was 1992, not 1996, I'm sorry. No, that's wrong. It had to be 88, thinking back to it, right? He derailed Clinton, he derailed Bush in 92.
Yeah.
That was the first Clinton term. But I think he had perceived what everyone, including Paul Ryan, is now crediting Donald Trump for seeing when no one else saw it. And that is a sense of forgottenness among people in working class and poor communities in Appalachia, in the Rust Belt, in the breadbasket of the nation. The other thing I'd point to about the same time was Jeffrey Bell's unjustly overlooked book called Populism and Elitism. That's a book that it would be very much worth going back and having a look at if you've read it before or looking at for the first time. Bell, too, perceived and tried to articulate a vision of a conservative populism at a time when populism was of interest mainly theoretically and historically, something associated with the late 19th century and early 20th century in the campaigns of William Jennings Bryan. But Bell believed that the time for populism's return was nigh, and he believed and wished to fashion a true conservative populism. It turned out, and Jones wrote about this, not to be at least at its leadership level, the populism that we got, which is not a conservative populism, although a struggle will now go on for the soul of the populist uprising that that Trump has led. I do think that at its heart, if we look at the Trump voters, and John can tell us whether this is true in the UK, of the Brexit supporters, we do see people who feel as though they have been forgotten. Not only forgotten in the sense that no one's looking after them or their interests, or honoring their values, but also forgotten in the sense that they feel as though they're treated as if they don't count as participants and citizens. That there's a ruling class, what Angelo Cotavilla, the political scientist, calls a ruling class, and they are not part of it. That perception is the perception that what has been lost is what Lincoln called Republican government, government not only of the people, which all government is, or indeed for the people, which all good government is, whether it's monarchical or aristocratic or whatever it is, but government by the people, including people in South Bend, Indiana, I mean the city, not the university, Harlan County, Kentucky, Boone County, West Virginia, in the farmlands in Kansas and Nebraska, and so forth. And I think that generated a resentment that Trump indeed did perceive. But it's important to see all the dimensions of it. Interests, values, sense of mattering or counting or being participants in the project of self-government. To be rulers and not merely being ruled. And this goes to their economic situation, to their sense of morality, and to their sense of partisan loyalty. In many cases, these are communities that have been historically democratic. Trump made some heavy inroads there, inroads that could not be made by Mitt Romney or John McCain, or even, as a matter of fact, by George W. Bush. And to the extent that inroads had been made, they'd been mainly made not on the economic situation or on participation issues, but on social values issues. The social conservatism was the appeal of Reagan, for example, to the Reagan Democrats. The perception is that the class that's ruling them not only lacks any ties to them as members of their community, but also lacks any real ties to them as members of the American nation. John referred to this as an international elite, and he's absolutely right. From the perspective of the guy who voted for the first time, or voted Republican for the first time, in voting for Trump in Harlan County, West Virginia, or in the who's on disability or unemployment in South Bend, Indiana, the ruling class is a class that isn't even patriotic. They're not surprised that the anti-Trump uprisings of the last 2 days involved burning the flag. It's what they'd expect. These are people with no real ties to the nation, no real ties to the religion of the people, but rather having contempt for the religion of the people. Their real allegiances are to folks like them, the international elite, who may be people in Brussels, who may be people in London, who may be people in Asia, but are not people from their religious communities or with ties of patriotism to their nation, much less sharing their moral values or their economic plight. And Trump really did tap into that. My sense from a distance of Brexit was that it was partly about concerns about immigration, but even there, those concerns were linked very tightly to a larger concern about sovereignty. Once again, the concern that people who aren't us are governing us, that Brussels is making the rules under which we live. An international elite, which will include some British folks, but not the common or working class British folks, the British elite, who are aligned with the French elite and the German elite and the Italian elite and have their values, not our values, who are ruling us. At least the people I know who were Brexit voters in Britain, and I think I knew all six of them in Oxford, were people who were concerned fundamentally about the loss of sovereignty and the right of the people to participate in the decisions, or at least be heard about the decisions that affected their lives.
Thanks, to you both. I want to shift a slightly different way, but stay on a kind of cultural broad landscape level to ask about the role of mediating institutions and what's been happening. Yuval Levine this fall came out with a book on the fractured republic, and part of his argument is that the weakening of mediating institutions and then the complexities of that. You know, a lot of what's been happening is a kind of individual protest against the state, globalization kind of reactions at those large levels. How has the role of mediating institutions and the role they play in shaping character affecting the landscape that you guys see? Robbie, why don't you start with some reflections?
Part of the reason, Yuval Levin's a very dear friend of mine, and I think the book is a magnificent book, The Fractured Republic. It's another important book. I'm assigning you books to Yuval Levin, The Fractured Republic. And while I'm at it, if you want to understand Trump, read J.D. Vance.
Oh, yeah.
J.D. Vance, Hillbilly Elegy. The name Trump, I think, doesn't appear in the book, but it'll tell you what you need to know about the things John and I were just talking about. The growth and intrusiveness of government has had, among many other effects, good and bad, the enervating of mediating institutions, what Burke called the little platoons, Tocqueville's institutions of civil society, that must, in any healthy, decent society, play the primary role in health, education, and welfare, and in transmitting to each new generation the values and the virtues necessary to lead successful lives and to be good citizens, therefore making possible a successful polity. Again, regardless of whether that polity is a democratic republic or some other kind of regime. And the weakening to the point in many communities, especially poor communities, white and black, and here J.D. Vance is right on the mark, because he's taken us out of center city Detroit and shown us southern Ohio and West Virginia and Kentucky and Tennessee. White or black, if you have collapse of the family, religion, the mediating institutions in those communities, government will have to come in. There will be no choice. It'll have to take over, fulfill the functions, perform the functions, ordinarily fulfilled by the family and the institutions of civil society like religion that support the family. Government will do it badly, and it will do it expensively. And government will grow for two reasons. One, to provide the cost of the services, to pay for the services, including policing, as the situation grows worse in terms of crime, gangs, and so forth, and incarceration. So we ought to be extremely concerned, and Yuval Levin is right to be ringing the bell about the collapse of the institutions of civil society. We should have been concerned when it was happening in poor minority communities. Daniel Patrick Moynihan in 1965 rang the alarm bell, long before Yuval was ever born, rang the alarm bell for his labors, liberal democratic Harvard professor working in a liberal administration launching the Great Society, yet for his labors, he was called a racist. He was accused of blaming the victim. You've all pointed out to me that the phrase blaming the victim originally was used against Moynihan. In effect, what happened was an example was made of Moynihan, and people became fearful of even mentioning the problems of family structure and family collapse and the collapse of the intermediate institutions in urban, poor, minority communities. And what happened? The situation just got worse and worse and worse. Nobody did anything about it. Every other explanation was tried out. Every other, the solutions that government proposed were all proportioned to the alternative explanations. Oh, it's all about jobs, It was partly about jobs, but it wasn't all about jobs. We're all about economics. We're all about something else. And the question of the intermediate institutions, especially the family, gets laid aside. It's too hot to handle. It's too difficult. You're going to suffer the fate of Moynihan if you do. And we got what we got. And not only did we get what we get. Moynihan was ringing the alarm bell, by the way, when the out-of-wedlock birth rate for African Americans was 25%. Moynihan said, this is unsustainable. This will destroy these communities. This will give rise to a plague of drug addiction, despair, violence, criminality, incarceration in a vicious cycle. But nothing was done. 25% began to rise to the point where it's now over 70%. And while for the general population in 1965, the out-of-wedlock birth rate was about 5%, the overall population, it's today over 40%. And among women in peak childbearing years, it's approaching 50%. The only thing Moynihan was wrong about is that he thought it had mainly to do with race and the history of racial oppression and injustice. Well, we now know, if you wonder about it, you can get the data from Bob Putnam's work, Charles Murray's work, Amber and David Lapp's work. We now know that it's more about culture than it is about race, because exactly what happened in urban minority communities in the 1950s and 60s, causing Moynihan to ring the alarm bell, has now happened in poor white working class communities, urban and or rural.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I think that, again, it might be worth saying something by way of comparison between the United States and the United Kingdom, partly for people's interest in information, but I think it also says something about what has happened in the United States and how quickly it's happened in the United States. First of all, these intermediary institutions, I mean, Robbie's referred to Burke, and Burke thinks of the family as it were as the starting point of society, and then these other sort of organically developed groupings that are, which you might even think of as families of families, a family of families, a community or something of that sort. And of course, de Tocqueville talks about the, you know, community of communities, this kind of sense of things. So that's one kind of intermediary institution, something that, as it were, grows out of the natural order of things, you might say. But there's another sort, which is voluntary associations gathered together around some shared project or common interest or some practice in life and so on. So professional groups, for instance, and some views trade unions, but, you know, societies of artists or, you know, stamp collectors or whatever else it may be. People gather together around, as Augustine said, the objects of their love, shared objects of their love. Now, these two sets of bodies, so they're slightly different, as it were. One comes from in the organic roots of some, you know, just the union of male and female and the family out of that among another. But the other is more arise at a later stage, is where people find that all of that is ongoing, but they find that they have particular interests or projects that they wish to pursue together, or they're engaged in common activities and they want to set standards for themselves and so on. So professional associations. Now, the importance of the latter, and I'll just say something about that for a moment. One of the characteristics of Russia, and one of the pervasive and continuing features of Russia from its history, going back to the 19th century, even the 18th century, under the Tsars, and then after the revolution, the Soviet period, and now the post-Soviet period, is the lack of those institutions. And I think Robbie spoke of these institutions as kind of facilitators or providers in some ways of natural goods, the family does that and so on. But the other thing that the secondary institutions that I spoke of can be the professional associations and such like, is also a resistance to the incursion of the state. And for a long time they set their own standards. I mean, the church is one such body as well. Now, what has happened is that the state has appropriated these various associations through patronage. And the way in which that's happened is different in the United Kingdom than the way in which it happened in the United States, but it's happened in the United States very quickly. In the United Kingdom, the state is the historical descendant of the church. In the medieval church provided healthcare, provided education, provided civil administration, and so on. I mean, the rebuilding of Europe was done out of the cathedral schools and then the colleges and universities. And, most people who entered religious life were entering it in order to become one kind or another of civil administrator. They were running the government in a way. And so in a country like Britain, there's a tendency to see things as provided from above, right? Mm-hmm. Historically, the above was the church. And of course, in a sense, the church received them from God. So there was a kind of linear and benign descent of manna upon the people. And then as with the decline of religion in the 18th and 19th centuries and disestablishmentarian movements and so on, the state starts to take up the position of the church. But you could say that in a country like Britain, the state is the descendant of the church as the benign, you know, provider. And so in Britain, the idea, for example, until quite recently, you would make any donation to a university was seen as perplexing as you might make a donation to the police station, right? I mean, these are just things that are provided for. Why would you expect anybody? Now, that is changing.
We want to encourage donations.
Yeah, I know. That's changing because of the economic situation, the cost of education, and indeed, just in general, as the state has taken on more, there just isn't the economic base to sustain this. But what's happened in the process has the patronage of the state has really made these independent groups increasingly the servants of the state. And also regulation of them makes them frightened of the state. Now, switching to the United States, I mean, there wasn't that history. I mean, the whole, you know, non-establishment of religion was prohibited precisely, that kind of coercive power operating, or, you know, initially benign, but the limits of coercive. It happens very rapidly. But what triggers it, I think, are the 1920s and 30s and then the Second World War. If you look at it, so it's the whole programs of the 1920s and 30s intended to address the aftermath of economic collapse. But then the war effort, and so if you look at photographs of Washington, D.C., for example, in the early part of the 20th century, and even into the 20s, it's a small southern town. It's only really with FDR, but then particularly with the Second World War, that all of these agencies come into being. And of course, once they got going, they've just grown in number, in reach, in power, in regulatory power, and as patrons. So if you want something, you want to run a project, you go into the National Endowment for the Humanities, or for the sciences, or medical sciences, whoever else it may be. And not only that, but if you want to try to do things, you need government, or at least you think you need government. So although the origins of these are different, the end effect of it is the same, is that the government has taken on this role of being this kind of overarching patron and regulator. And in the course of all of that, the institutions, whether they're the organic institutions of the family, the seeds of whose collapse lie elsewhere, but then are accelerated by all of this, because you finance people in their chaotic lives and so on. Whether it's that, or whether it's these other institutions that I was talking about, secondary institutions, things like professional groups and so on. And I think there is a real concern, one should have a real concern, that we might be moving into a situation, already in, but move further into a situation in which 10 or 20 years' time there will be no sources of resistance to the state. A state which, by the way, is increasingly becoming an administrative state, where the business of the state is carried on by unelected officials. But I think the role of these intermediary institutions, not just the family, but the professional bodies and so on, is extremely important in resisting the incursions of the state. And the lesson of Russia in the 18th and 19th century, in the Soviet period, the post-Soviet period, is what happens to a society, in that case, that never had intermediary institutions, but in our case, one whose intermediary institutions have been co-opted and corrupted.
Can I lay some emphasis on one point that Professor Haldane has made here? And this is the idea, the reality, the fact, that when institutions of civil society are functioning in a healthy way, they will provide a kind of buffer between the central state and the individual citizen. One way to look at it is the way in which families, churches, civic associations, professional associations provide alternative authority structures to the state. When they are flattened, when they are wiped out, the individual is defenseless against the overwhelming power of the state. If you look at the conservative movement historically, what it's going to look like from this past Tuesday forward, we don't know yet, and that's a big and very interesting issue. There are dangers and opportunities.
But if you look at it historically, the modern conservative movement, the Bill Buckley conservative movement, it's what Buckley's associate Frank Meyer called a fusion movement, a fusion of social conservatives, mainly religious, and libertarians, often secular. One of the common points, they have many differences, but one of the common points that made that fusion possible is a deep concern about big government, overreaching government, and especially about the administrative state, the rise of the administrative, all-controlling state. Where, I would offer to my libertarian friends the following, where the social conservatives, and especially the religious conservatives, get it more right than the libertarians, is that the social conservatives are aware that the dangers of big government are not only dangers to individual liberty. The libertarians put the focus on the threat that big government poses to individual liberty. They're not wrong about that, but they're half right. Social conservatives, religious conservatives, agree with that, that there's a grave threat to individual liberty, but they also notice, and unrelatedly notice that, I'm sorry, and relatedly notice that there's a threat to the institutions of civil society as well. And if you want to, you should want to protect the institutions of civil society for its own sake because of the important role they play in overall, the overall thriving, the flourishing of the community. But also if you're worried about the liberty of the individual citizen, you need that protective role that's played, that buffering role that's played by the institutions of civil society. When Tocqueville came here in the 1830s to study our prisons and got fascinated with our democracy, when Tocqueville got here, he noticed that there was a difference between what the functioning of these institutions in old Europe and in the United States, and that they were functioning in the United States in a way that made sense of, what could be made sense of in light of American democracy, what John calls the disestablishment principle, and also American republicanism. And what has emerged from that, if we now look back many, many, many decades since, is a different kind of conservatism. American conservatism is not the throne and altar conservatism of Europe or the blood and soil conservatism of old Europe. It's rather, essentially, old-fashioned liberalism. American conservatives are old-fashioned liberals. They're Madisonian, Tocquevillian liberals, not least because of their concern and regard for the institutions of civil society.
So I'm going to return to your question about resistance and your description of a healthy society in just a moment. But first I want to ask, you reflect on both countries have an awful lot of people who claim to be at least nominally or substantively Christians who would have had some appreciation for these intermediary institutions of a civil society, attention to habits and virtues and character, presumably. How did Christians allow, cause, contribute to, or become complicit in creating the mess we're in?
Well, there we go. Right. again, I think that the story...
This is why I'm glad you're here.
Yeah. I think the story... sorry, is this one on just now? Can you hear me at the back? Is this... It just sounds as if it might not be on this microphone. Yeah. I don't. Yeah, hang on a second. Yeah. Yes, that is on, definitely. Yeah. I think that, again, the story is probably going to be different on either side, but I think partly the establishment of the Church of England, and then in Scotland, well, the Church of Scotland was established, it was disestablished, but it's what's called a protected church, so it has certain legal protections uniquely among Christian denominations, or indeed any religious group in Scotland. So effectively, these two churches were national churches. And no doubt there were respects in which that was a good thing. I mean, it was an expression of the Christian identity of the nation and so on. But it was also a corrupting thing. It meant that people, as it were, took for granted, I mean, the agents of these churches, took for granted that these people would be there because they were baptized into it. It was part of the cultural form and such like. And probably didn't do enough, really, to try to... I mean, the Church of Scotland, for example, did great things from the 16th century onwards and so on. But I'm talking, once you get industrialization, people coming in off the land, you've got new centres of population, there are no historic parishes in these areas, or certainly not sufficient to accommodate the number of people and so on, then you do get a significant social change going on. And then with the rise of the labour movement, which was historically in Britain actually associated in part with Methodism in Wales, with Roman Catholicism in Scotland, through Irish immigration and so on. So there were religious kind of affiliations. But by stages, much later on, the economic left, I mean, the people who on the left were concerned with questions of redistribution, abandoned those interests in favor of kind of social and cultural revolutions. But what happened along the way, I think, was that the religious denominations simply lost contact with their people. I mean, one of the, I mean, talked about the church as a kind of facilitator of life and a provider and so on. So it would have been the case in the past that a very common sight, which of course you would still get in the United States, but thinking about Britain now, would be a church hall, a school, and so on. So this really would be the center of the community, and it would provide the basic facilities for most of, not all of life, but most of life. Well, that began to break up post-war. The result of extensive bombing was that these old communities were broken up, people moved out, and so on. And the church didn't really find a role. Now, just to give you an indication of the state of things in Great Britain, which is a much more secular, and in the sort of popular sense of secular, kind of anti-religious society, it used to be the case that if one was asked to sort of identify the number of Christians in a given denomination, you would take the total number that would be identified, through baptism, and then you divide that a third, a third, a third. So you'd say a third of those baptized will not enter church again, say possibly on the occasion of their death or subsequent to it. A third will, you know, turn up for Christmas, Easter, and whatever other occasional festivals there are and so on. But a third would be more or less regular participants. Over the last 20 years, 25 years, that active third has dropped now to probably about 10%. So 10% of baptized Christians have anything that would constitute a kind of ongoing religious life. And I'm not talking about a prayer life, I just mean the sense in which an attendance at a church and things of that sort. And that number is dropping fast. So the first church to die in Britain will probably be the Church of Scotland. The Church of Scotland is almost dead. Because it's a legally protected institution, it has certain securities, as it were, inbuilt to it. But I would say the Church of Scotland is within about 20 years of death. So you know, these churches and parishes are developed and so on are simply empty. And nobody knows what to do about this. One consequence, I think, has been the effort to try to engage social questions. And in fact, an American who came over to Scotland, a woman who was an ordained minister, was in the Kirk, the Church of Scotland. She recently led a campaign in which it was called something like, you know, a 100 ideas for 100 years or something, or maybe it was, you know, 1,000 ideas for 1,000 years. But the idea was, so this is the head of one of the offices of the Church of Scotland, they went out into the street and invited people to list 100 good ideas or 10 good ideas, however many they could manage, that would make Scotland a better country. And no mention of any of this was there any mention of religion. None whatsoever. And indeed, when this matter was raised, it was said, well, we don't really want to put people off, you know, so we don't want to ask about religion. So, now, that, if you wanted evidence of a church that has ceased to have a soul, then that's it. The Church of Scotland is effectively dead. I mean, there are good ministers carrying on. I speak to members of the church. I'm not a member of the Church of Scotland myself, but I've spoken to a kind of forward and faith group who are trying to work out what to do. They will probably eventually leave, you know, that we fall. The one element of growth in that sort of sector is the Free Church of Scotland.
Oh, the Wee Freeds?
The Wee Freeds, yeah. Which, of course, famously, I mean, part of that sort of schism in the 19th century and so on was over the question of establishment. So we come back to this idea. Now, switching again, just very quickly to the United States, the Roman Catholic Church, for example, which is the church that I know best, is in pretty serious difficulties. Some of those are to do with the sexual abuse scandal, but I think that's more as well an occasion. I think people feel in some ways justified in their apostasy, if one wants to put it that way, by finding cause to justify that. I don't think that's really a driving cause of people's abandonment of faith. So I think among younger people, of course, it is a factor. But the rates of lapsation within the Christian churches now are tremendous and accelerating. And even here in the United States, I think was historically genuinely different because of non-establishment, lapsation is proceeding apace in all of the major churches. I guess that the exceptions to that might be Pentecostalist, independent churches and things of that sort, but the historic traditional Christian denominations, it seems to me, are obvious decline and rapid decline.
I keep coming back to Tocqueville, but one of the things Tocqueville noticed in the 1830s was that religion was thriving here, not so much in his own native Europe. And it was thriving here not only despite non-establishment, but he quickly figured out because of non-establishment, and the multiplicity of sects actually created a kind of religious vibrancy. In the country, and I think that has continued. I mean, we are suffering fairly high rates of lapsation now, but we in the United States tend to have these revivals, these awakenings, and so forth. Some of the new movements in the old churches and some of the new churches show signs of that kind of vibrancy. But this takes us back to the conversation we began with. There are two nations, not in the sense that John Edwards spoke of it a few years ago, but there is religious America and there is secular America. I live in secular America. I myself am a believer and active in my church, but I live in largely secular America. You guys live in more religious America.
I just moved to it.
What's it like? But folks in religious America, because most Americans still are religious. Rates of church attendance are not as high as they were, but daily prayer, if people are telling the truth, belief itself, belief in God, belief in fundamental Christian doctrines, the willingness to say prayers, those kinds of things are still very high. But they are flourishing among the American population, not among the American elite. So there's a real division. It's not that religious practice and belief are about the same in the two sectors, the elite and the popular. They're very different. The people who have more power are less religious, leading the sociologist Peter Berger to make the astute remark that if India is the most religious nation, and if Sweden is the most secular or least religious nation, then America is a nation of Indians governed by Swedes. That ruling class that Pat Buchanan promised to energize the peasants with their pitchforks against, that Donald Trump has tapped into, those tend to be a lot more religious, and there's a lot of resentment about these secular, internationalist, globalist elites controlling the country and deciding big issues of social policy and social morality, including like what marriage is, or what the bathroom policy of the country will be, or whether abortion will be legal or the unborn will be protected or what have you.
Thank you. Two more questions before asking someone to ask you each to be brief, although they're huge questions. So. And unfair to ask you to be brief, but I want to ask you first, because it's a more U.S.-centric question, though with implications for England as well. If you think about what healthy or resistance would look like, and it's interesting the two different words you used, we've got on offer, the older Martin Luther King kind of civil rights mindset, how Christians ought to be engaged in rebuilding culture. Then you have Richard Neuhaus, who actually came of age in the civil rights era, and then made a turn and proposed a crowded public square as an alternative to the naked public square, but a very active, engaged environment. Now you have Rod Dreher talking to younger folks, especially about the Benedict option, appealing to McIntyre's famous closing in After Virtue. Russell Moore talking about the loss of millennials' conviction about the religious right, etc. Where would you recommend, particularly younger people, Baylor students who are thinking about how to engage culture and politics for the 21st century in the most fruitful ways, what's the model that they ought to be thinking about?
Well, Rod Dreher is terrific. I love his work. I love his writing. I commend it to you, especially younger folks who are here read Dreyer, learn everything you can from him. I like everything but his conclusions. to the extent that I understand the conclusions, and every time I hear an explanation from Rod or someone sympathetic to Rod about what the Benedict option is, I get more confused about exactly what it is. But maybe it'll all be explained in the new book that Rod has coming out. I think maybe it's already out, but I haven't yet read it, but I'm looking forward to it. Now, there's plenty of truth in the adage that politics and policy are downstream from culture. If you want to change the policy, you change the culture.
Sure.
But there's also truth in the following statement. Law and policy shape culture, and culture shapes conduct, just as culture shapes law and policy, from which I draw the conclusion that we had better not think of these as either-or propositions or strategies. It's not a question of whether we withdraw from the political sphere and try to shape the culture, or we withdraw from the cultural issues and just focus entirely on politics. We all need to be concerned and at some level active in both the culture and politics, and we shouldn't even treat them as separate. I mean, politics is part of the wider culture. Now, it's fine for various people with various callings or vocations or missions that they discern in their own lives. It's fine to put your personal focus on this or that. Not everybody has to be working in the political sphere. Not everybody has to be working in crisis pregnancy centers or working in churches or other culture-shaping institutions. But we should not, individually or collaboratively, draw the conclusion that it really is either or and we need to put all our focus on one or the other. It's both and. We need to be working to create a film industry that provides alternatives to the messages that we are getting in American film. Same with music. That kind of work on the cultural side is very important. But we also need to be involved in and supporting advocacy groups or standing up for what's right, involved in political campaigns, trying to make sure that the best possible people are elected to public office, because politics does matter. If we keep in mind the relationship between politics and policy on the one side and culture on the other, we're going to do just fine.
Yes, I think if talking about younger people in particular, I would say that, I mean, we live in a world in which the pervasive culture is not only has little to say about religion, what it has to say is critical of it. So I would say that the first thing that one might do, I mean, I agree with these the idea of these dual strategies and so on, but I would say that to sort of form groups united around an attempt to understand, say, the Christian faith. I mean, I think one has to get the foundations right, and you can't necessarily hope, as one might have done in an earlier day, that those are simply going to be transmitted as part of the early formation. And so trying to sort of find, through scripture, and also, I think, through a historical understanding of Christian history, particularly the history of the early church, which was living in times that in some ways have their parallels to the times in which we find ourselves today. I think these two are tremendous resources, and I think they're liable to encourage a sense not of optimism, but of hope. And that's, it's always worth developing hope and not being misled by optimism.
That's good.
But I think that, and then I think on the basis of that, starting to try to understand what's going on culturally, as it bears upon religion, as it moves away from religion and so on. Finding, I would say, a church, I mean, a sense, a denominational church, okay, something that is, as it were, rooted, so one has a kind of check on one's own journey, that there are other points one can take account of, particularly points that involve families and others and so on. So you see that sort of broader Christian community. And then from that point on, I think it's discovering one's own gifts and talents and trying to act upon those, whether in the way of trying to influence the culture, or whether in the way of trying to shape the politics.
When it comes to, John, I wonder if you would agree with this, when it comes to the errors that lead people and societies astray, my impression is that there is very rarely something new. Old errors, old mistakes in thought, especially in the domain of ethics, just come back in new forms and need to be addressed. Again, I have an article on the issued just now, the December issue of First Things, called Gnostic Liberalism, in which I make the argument that an awful lot of the errors that we're seeing today in relation to the sanctity of human life, marriage and the family, and so forth, transgenderism, are rooted in a revival of the old heresy of Gnosticism, which leads me to think that it's very good for students, especially Christian students, to familiarize themselves with the ancient struggles over heresy and orthodoxy in the church. Read the church fathers, understand church history, because this is a tape that keeps rerunning, and we'll be better equipped to address it this time and the next time if we understand how the church successfully addressed it before.
Just very quick, one thought just right before that. Sorry, it's just you mentioned one heresy, I'm going to mention another, because the heresy that you were mentioning, you were seeing as it were re-expressing itself within a secular context, yes, the Gnosticism and so on. But there's a religious heresy that I think re-expresses itself within a religious context, and that's Pelagianism. I think many Christians are Pelagians. That's to say, they believe that they can achieve some sort of moral perfection, or at any rate moral advance, singly and collectively, by their own fruits alone. And that this derives from Pelagius, I have to say, an English monk. But the whereas, you know, Augustine is very clear on the idea that however we work, as well as the question of merit attaching through the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, but we're also just burdened by the effects of sin. And I think it's important to bear that in mind, because I think many Christians kind of leave that side in a so happy, you know, upward path, forget that problem.
I'm going to save my last question for the very close of our time together, in the interest of getting some questions from the gathered folk here. Jonathan Trant's working around, so.
Earlier in the conversation, you talked about the importance of these intermediate social bodies. I think that's right. You know, we need these intermediate social bodies. But in your conversation, it seems like there was a class of bodies left out, which was national and multinational corporations. And it seems to me that the importance of this absence is that it sustains a picture of the world where you can talk about government having incursions into our lives. But considering the effects of national multinational corporations, it might lead you to talk differently. For example, to speak of the ways that government provides a check on these corporations being the ones left to determine and shape our lives and habits. And you can see this particularly, for example, around healthcare, right? So it's not the case that absent government's involvement in healthcare, you just have a bunch of mom and pop hospitals and take care of our communities. It's the case that our healthcare was governed by big pharma and corporations, and then government comes into the picture. So I wonder if you can comment on, given the existence of these bodies in our world, what does that do to the position of government?
Yeah, it's a very good, can I address it first? Is this on? Can I borrow? It's a very good and important point, and the situation is even more challenging. I think you probably would have gone into this yourself, but what it suggests to me is the additional problem, which is government regulation, any particular national government's regulation, or any attempt to create international institutions to regulate international corporations, suffers from the problem of the governments being captured by the international corporations. In a world where banks are too big to fail and governments have to come in to bail out big banks, despite problems that are created not only by mismanagement but even criminality, and no one pays any penalty for it, and as a matter of fact, people are welcomed into the halls of power. That's a really bad situation, and no one, as far as I can tell, has come up with a very good plan for dealing with that. And it's part of the appeal of the movements that we were talking about at the beginning of the conversation. There is an international elite. It's political. It's social. It is economic. You know, they get together in Martha's Vineyard, or, you know, in the south of France and in various places. And, you know, we're not part of it. But all that, those concentrations of of power are used to shape our lives. It's not always malignant. It's not that they're out to hurt us. Even those corporations that are out to just make money for their shareholders, make money for them for themselves, know that they to make money, they're going to have to provide products and services. They got to be reasonably affordable. You need people who make some money in order to pay the bills for the goods and services. So we shouldn't have a view of them as merely rapacious. And yet, the point that you made is correct. And it's very challenging to figure out, I certainly haven't figured out a very good way that you can regulate them or even avoid capture. Donald Trump has proposed, it's just a full disclosure, I've been a very ferocious critic of Trump's there. I was a ferocious critic of the other competitor as well. But I have to credit him with a very good idea. He's promised to introduce legislation that would restrict entry into government from people who were beneficiaries of government largesse, or entry into corporate leadership of people who had been in regulatory positions with respect to government, to try to cut regulatory positions with respect to corporations, to try to cut back on the reality that people will use their government service as a springboard for earning a lot of money entering the corporate sector, and sometimes come into government with a view to landing lucrative positions down the line, and to try to deal with the reality that, without attributing to anybody malicious motives, that it is in your interest when you're a government regulator who may eventually be employed in the private sector to have good relationships with the people you are regulating. Now, this isn't to say that I think that you should have hostility between the regulators and the regulated, but you do need an arm's length situation, some distance. So I do applaud Trump for this, and it shouldn't have taken Trump, right? We shouldn't have had to wait for Donald Trump to get some protections like that, common sense protections like that into our laws.
We go to another question.
Hi, I'm Alex. I'm a neuroscience major here at Baylor. Just a small question. Given the large pushback against use of religious morals, given the large pushback against political figures using religious morality as a way of informing their decisions, what do you think that the role of religious views should serve in policy decisions? And I don't just mean Judeo-Christian tradition, just religion in general.
Well, this has become the subject of a good deal of sort of academic discussion as well as more popular discussion. I mean, I say more popular, I mean sort of think pieces in broadsheet newspapers and so on, around the way in which it would sometimes be cast as in relation to what's called public reason. And the question would be, what sort of reasoning and reasons may you adduce in the context of deliberating about policy in the public square? And a certain kind of liberal has wanted to argue that the only reasons that you can advance are reasons that are of a kind that anyone can accept. Not the reason itself might not be, but they belong to a class of reasons that anyone can accept. And that's straight off probably going to rule out religious considerations, right? Because not everybody's going to accept religious considerations, or certain kind of ideological, obviously ideological considerations. Now, that's just actually a recipe of sort of for evacuating reason of substance, right? Because you can just push this iteratively against almost any set of considerations, moral considerations, well, not everybody's going to accept those and so on. But that device has been deployed by people, in some cases, I think people have not seen this consequence, so it would have to be pretty dim not to. But I think in the case of others, it's simply been an implement to actually prize religion out of the public square. So I think the response to that is to say, look, when it comes to public deliberation, anything goes. I mean, when I say anything goes, what I mean is anything within the sphere of the reasonable goes. This is not a constrained notion of public reason.
I mean, you don't just get to shout at people for the sake of it, right? You have to advance reasons, and you have to advance things that have a broadly speaking argumentative structure, that one thing supports another, and so on. But subject to those kind of constraints, I'm going to say that, as in any other practical sphere, you bring anything you can to bear in the attempt to resolve it. What I don't think you can do in a pluralist society is to prioritize one source of reasons and say, well, these are the reasons that are decisive or trump, right? And those days have gone. We do live in pluralist societies in that sense. We live in that sense, post-ideological societies, there are other senses, a lot of ideology about. But there I would just say, as in any other sphere of practical deliberation, you bring, you know, the totality of life experience and whatever seems a relevant reflection and so on. And so what one has to argue for here is being allowed to reason in that way. And that will allow space for religion.
Yeah, I might have a little crack at this one myself. All of the public reason stuff is coming from one direction. So let me just give you some advice. If one of your liberal secularist friends invite you to put your arms into a straitjacket, just decline the invitation.
Yeah.
If you believe something is true, something pertaining to justice, human rights, the common good, if you believe that is true, then you've got a good reason to act on that belief in your life as a citizen. Now, I would hope that you would be able to defend with arguments your reasons. Not everybody can, and they shouldn't be disenfranchised as citizens of a republic if they can't. But I would hope, especially for people being educated at a distinguished university, that you would be able to reason your way to your positions and give arguments. But we shouldn't think that there's this division between reason and faith, this sharp distinction between reason and faith, and that religious reasons are reasons that are just kind of blindly grabbed and are just infused into your head by God in some direct sense, or whispered into your ear by your clergyman or something like that. That's a liberal secularist, liberal caricature of what religious people actually think and how they reason. And especially if we believe, as most Christians, not all, but as most Christians believe, that God's will is not arbitrary, that God himself has reasons for his commandments, reasons for his rules, reasons for the principles of morality that Christians have historically and traditionally affirmed. And if there are such reasons, they ought to be accessible. We ought to be able to use our God-given gift of reason in order to discern or understand those. Sometimes that's called natural law thinking. It doesn't matter what label you attach to it. You should try to understand what human goods are served by the norms of morality that you believe in, and why a concern for those goods integrally considered generates the moral principles that you want to act on in your own life and that you think people in general should act on. Think public policy should be shaped in light of. So what I want to encourage you to do is to be an active, engaged, reasoning citizen, one who's making arguments with everybody, with fellow believers, but also with unbelievers in the public square, but not one who falls for the trick of being told, well, you know, I have this belief, I think it's true, sure, it relates to justice and the common good, but somehow it's associated with my religion. So, you know, I can't act on this. This is one of the dumbest things said in this entire campaign, filled with dumb presidential campaigns, filled with dumb things, was Tim Kaine's claim that he couldn't act on his own views about the inherent and equal right to life of the unborn child because they were somehow associated with his Catholic faith. One of the things that proves, in the slightest idea, what the Catholic faith teaches about the subject.
One question over on this side, perhaps. Jonathan, up here.
You can maybe move down at this time, too.
Thanks very much for the talk. It seems like one of the effects of losing these mediating institutions is a stronger reliance on the state. And from my perspective, it seems like whether it's in sort of local communities or the national level, we have an erosion of trust in the institutions of government, and we don't actually sort of believe that they're going to provide the conditions for justice that the society needs. I'm curious how we should go about restoring trust in those institutions when it's no longer potentially reasonable to trust them, and sort of what our individual obligations and duties are in light of that problem.
Thank you very much. He just said you go first, yeah. I think that the question of trust becomes problematic as the scale of a society grows and you get groups and so on that are operating independently or semi-independently. In small communities, to some extent, trust is less necessary because everybody can see what the immediate effects of what's going on in one thing and another. But at certain stages, trust becomes an important virtue there. I think when you reach a certain scale, and we are in that scale, because even if you live in a small community, your life is being impacted by institutions, organizations, operations, I mean, this goes back in a way to what was said earlier on, that don't reside there, and you know nothing about them, and such like. So there, I think that all I can offer there is that I think there's something to be said for introducing mechanisms of things like oversight, trying to, insofar as it's possible, secure transparency, having independent representatives on boards and things of that kind. And I think that some people might say, well, because that doesn't seem very trusting. Well, no, that's the whole point, right? It's because trust has broken down that it becomes necessary to try to give people some assurance that we do at least have mechanisms in place.
In the United States, John, we refer to that as the principle of trust but verify.
There you go. Very well put, yeah. So we want verifiers, yeah.
One of the problems, Matt, is you put your finger on it, which is that it's not just the institutions of government, it's institutions generally that have lost trust. People don't trust the institutions of religion. They don't trust private companies and corporations. They don't trust the military. I mean, military used to be way up on the trust scale. The courts, especially the Supreme Court, that used to be way up on the trust scale. Well, the emperor has turned out not to have any clothes, and people now, see the naked emperor, and now the trust in all of these institutions has deteriorated. And I think to win it back, it will require the kind of verifying transparency mechanisms that Haldane is talking about. It would be foolish to trust institutions, and of course the institutions are just people, right? Trust people who are untrustworthy, who have proven to be untrustworthy. I know John and I are both Catholics, and in the Catholic Church, the sex scandals, the priest scandals, which were a very small percentage of priests, but still, the priest scandals have just profoundly eroded trust, especially in the bishops who were trying to deal with these problems and supervise the priests and come up with ways of handling the complaints, whether they're fair to the priests and also fair to the victims or alleged victims. And it's very, very difficult. But the net result is there are good reasons not to trust. And the only way to overcome that is to do what the bishops are doing, putting mechanisms in place that provide for transparency and verification.
I want to take the privilege of the chair and ask a final question that returns to the theme of reasons for our hope and the word education, and invite you both to offer a word about what role Baylor as a Christian research university ought to play in addressing the role of faith in politics, culture, and education as we look to the future.
So I'm going to have to be very careful, aren't I, what I say? You may need to be very careful as well if you want it. Yeah. So, one of the things that has brought me to Baylor is that I admire the project that it's involved in. At previous stages of my life, I've held positions at Georgetown University and the University of Notre Dame, to mention two American Christian institutions. They have sought to combine a commitment to teaching, to scholarship and research, and to a Christian mission, and they've gone in certain ways. I think that gone or are going in certain ways, perhaps I should say. I think that Baylor is in a possibly unique institution in the United States. It's an educational institution of a certain size and reach and power, with graduate programs and so on, but a very strong commitment to undergraduate education, but also a strong and unapologetic commitment to Christian belief and witness. Now, this is ongoing and it may go in different directions. We'll have to see how it's developed, but I know that people are very committed to holding together those three aspects of things: teaching, scholarship, and Christian commitment. Now, it seems to me, even in the short time that I've been here, though I've visited a couple of times in the past, I am very struck by the fact that, though there may be, we could pursue this in slightly different ways with different emphasis on each of the three things that I've mentioned, that this really is a place in which you can see that these three streams are running and mingling and so on. And I think the power of that to carry people forward, and indeed to carry the institution forward, so long as people, you know, hold fast, test everything and hold fast to that which is good, as St. Paul said. As long as people hold fast to that, I think it's, I think it'll work, and I also think it'll bring tremendous benefits, both to those who are immediate participants, whether it's students or teachers or others employed in the university or around in the university, but also to the larger Baylor family, as people go out as graduates and so on, and we've heard about, you know, generations associated with the institution, and there'll be relatively few who have that deep historical connection, but as the years pass, there will be others who will emulate and follow that as well. And so I think that that's what's going on here, I think, is extremely good. But, you know, nothing can be taken for granted. One has to identify it, be clear about it, and remain committed to it.
Okay, remember, you asked for this. My advice as an outside friend, I hope something of a member of the family, a distant relative, my advice is to make sure that liberal arts learning is at the heart of a Baylor education. And that means not only that there should be a strong liberal arts program, but that everyone, including students who, for very good reasons, have to do with their own lives and their own ambitions and their own careers and vocations, are not majoring in liberal arts subjects, nevertheless, cannot escape from this place without a strong liberal arts foundation. So that's number one. Number two, this is a Christian institution. It's got to remain a Christian institution. The principles of the Christian faith should guide the institutional decisions of the university. Don't believe me. Do believe me, but don't. Not going to believe I've used that Trumpian term. Believe me. Yeah. Believe me. No. What you don't want to do is try to become the Baptist Princeton, or the Baptist Harvard, or the Baptist Stanford. They should try to become more like Baylor. You shouldn't try to become more like them. That is the root of secularization, abandonment of Christian principle for glory and fame and status in the intellectual world and all that stuff. Believe me. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Now, that also means, I think, not only that the institution's decision should be guided by the faith of the institution, but also that every Baylor student, whether he or she is a Christian or not, I'm sure that there are Jewish students, there are students from Asian backgrounds, there are students who are unbelievers, but every Baylor student understands the basics of what the Christian church teaches and is historically taught, and why it teaches those things, as opposed to other things that it could have taught. And some appreciation of the history of Christian faith, how this tiny Jewish sect, being peddled by a few Galilean fishermen, ends up a faith of world historical significance. Whether it's the true faith or not, ends up with this kind of world historical significance. So that's another thing that I think is critical for Baylor students to understand. Next to last, there should never be a strong, sharp division between faith and reason. Faith should, and reason should always be understood. If I can, you know, share with the Baptists a Catholic image that was provided by Pope John Paul II, saying Pope John Paul II now in his encyclical letter on faith and reason. Faith and reason are the two wings on which the human spirit ascends to contemplation of the truth. I'm a hillbilly from West Virginia. I grew up in the mountains hunting and fishing, and so forth. And occasionally you'd wing a bird, a ruffed grouse or a pheasant or something. You'd wing a bird, and the bird would have a wounded wing down there on the ground. And it might have, the other wing might be great, and it might be flapping like crazy with the other wing, and it's just going around in circles, and it's not getting off the ground, and it's not going anywhere because you can't, if you're a bird, get along with just one wing. It takes two. And that's also true of Christian faith. Faith and reason really are the two wings on which the human spirit ascends to contemplation of the truth. And so our formation must be both, our formation of our students must be both an intellectual formation and a religious formation. And those aren't really separate. They can't be done as separate things. They're an integrated whole. And our formation of our students should be intellectual and religious. We should be concerned about that. That doesn't mean forcing Christianity on our students who are not Christian. And I think Baylor's policy, I believe it is to admit students who want to be at Baylor, even if they're not Christian, something I very much approve of. I wouldn't want Christianity to be imposed on non-Christian students, and yet it should be available. The vibrancy of a Christian faith on campus should be something that all Baylor students, including those who are not themselves Christians, see. Now, the final thing is this. Christianity is a very fine religion, very odd, very idiosyncratic. It's got two dimensions that appear to the world, to worldly eyes, to be utterly incompatible. But if you've got hold of the thing, you know they're not. And that is, this is a faith that calls on all of its adherents to be prepared for martyrdom. What's Jesus saying when he's asking, what does it mean to be a disciple of his? He's very clear on this. It means taking up my cross, taking up your cross and following me. Boy, there's a great invitation when I convert somebody to a religion. What's on offer? What do you get out of the deal? Work, fame, wealth, power, influence? No, a cross. You want to be my disciple, take up your cross and follow me. But this is also a religion that holds that we should not be morose or dour or sad, but hopeful. And because we are hopeful, joyful. Knowing how the story ultimately ends, getting to peek at the last page and see where all this is going. So even though we must prepare for martyrdom, which is a serious preparation in today's world in a wide variety of ways, I don't mean that there's a threat to your physical, biological life. You know what I'm talking about. This is not an easy time to be a serious Christian in this culture and in this polity. So while we need to be prepared, seriously prepared, and ready to be, willing to be, ready to be martyrs, we also need to be joyful future martyrs. We have to be joyful because we do have hope. We know how the story ends.
On that note, we're ready for high tea. Let me thank the Drumwright family.
Good.
Thank you so much.